And good evening. I'd like to call the Planning Commission meeting to order for Thursday, March 9th, 2017. Mr. Hanke, could we have a reading of a call of the
roll
members
call.
Present? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Spinito.
Present.
Commissioner Chappell. Commissioner French. Commissioner McBride.
Here.
Vice Chairman Ogden, you have a quorum.
Thank you, Mr. Hanke. We'll defer public comments until we get through a couple of the things here on the agenda, item two. Item three, approval of minutes from the regular meeting held January 12, 2017. Mr. Hanke, I don't think we're able to do that.
No, Chairman, we're not going to be able to approve the minutes of January 12th or February 23rd's workshop because of a lack of quorum of commissioners that were in attendance there but not here tonight. So we'll have to move on to the main item.
Actually, either one of those, we won't be able to approve those minutes, correct?
That's correct.
January 12th, January 23rd.
We'll
Thank
have
you.
To, we'll have to table those until the April meeting.
Thank you. Item five, discussion and possible action concerning a request for a special use permit at 1214 East Vilas Avenue to operate a commercial daycare business in the area zoned single-family residential. Mr. Hanke, do we have a report from staff, please?
Yes, as mentioned, the Planning Department did receive an application for a special use permit at 1214 East Vilas Avenue for the purpose of operating a commercial daycare business in an R1 single-family dwellings. I have provided you with your packet tonight in the glossary of terms, the difference in the definitions of a family daycare, home daycare, and a commercial child care. The family daycare restricts the number of children to 5 children, and that includes any that might live in the house. If you want more than 5, you have to step up to the child care center commercial. And the reason that we're making application tonight is because this is a commercial type business and we're asking for relief of the zoning requirement here because this area is zoned for single family dwellings only. The applicant is Mr. Brian Tyson, and the notification protocol is typical and it was in effect to all the utilities. Notice was published in the Guthrie News Leader on January 28th. And 24 notification letters were mailed to property owners within 300 feet of the subject property. The office has received no calls or letters in support or against opposing this item. The applicant is here tonight, or the representative is here tonight, to answer any specific questions you might have.
Are there any commission members with any questions for Mr. Hanke before we proceed with that? I might ask Mr. Hanke, the number of children you say on family is up to 6 or 5, and what is it? Is there a number on commercial? Is there a maximum number?
No, there's not. It just says for 6 or more children.
Any other questions of Mr. Hanke before we?
I do have one comment to make. If tonight you approve this application and send it on to the City Council for their consideration, I will have to note that at that point, we will need a copy of the applicant's state license from the Department of Human Services because one of our conditions to issue the special use permit is for the applicant to have a state DHS license for that child daycare.
Okay, and I'm sorry, the name again of our applicant is here?
Is Brian Tyson.
Mr. Tyson, would you like to
are you Mr. Tyson?
Talk to us a little bit here to the podium? Just come right on up the podium and
make sure you step up also.
Sure, sure, you bet.
Before they begin, I want to make sure that I'm operating on the right page. In the process that we're going through right now, it will be the Department of Human Services that actually gives the license. Our purpose here tonight is solely to determine if it meets the zoning requirements within the city's long-range plan.
Well, yeah.
And the zoning plan.
Well, yes, they don't meet the requirements of the zoning because it's zoned as single family.
Right.
So their use is applying for a special use permit to operate
okay.
there.
Okay.
Yes, I'm the owner of the house, but she would be the one that's
license.
She's the one that's licensed to do the daycare.
Okay.
So do you already have your daycare license and stuff?
From the state?
From the state?
Yes, I just recently closed my daycare down in March, and I'm reopening back up again. I have my daycare in Oklahoma City, and I have my previous license from when it was in Oklahoma City, but I'm relocating to here to reopen up my daycare.
Is this the house that, is this the house I see in the picture?
1214 East 5th.
Yes, yes.
14.
So DHS will have to look at your facility and then reissue a license for this particular address?
Right.
Okay. Has that been done yet?
Again, and I have to get it set up, and they have to go in again and make sure everything is set up
Okay.
the right
Okay.
way and all of that, and then they reissue
Okay.
my license.
We just want you to know that before our special use might be granted, if they vote for it and the council votes for it, that you would need to have that DHS license before our permit would be effective.
Okay.
Okay.
So I'm sorry, I have a question.
Okay.
So in order to be able to get the house set up like it needs to be set up, we also need that permission, right, to do that from you guys.
Well, we can help you out in the regard that if it would be approved by the Planning Commission and the Council, that a stipulation would be put on there for it to be effective is contingent upon the Department of Human Services also approving it.
Okay.
Yeah.
And possibly clarification, Mr. Hanke, so we have the owner, and
yes.
we have
yeah.
going to be the proprietor.
Right. Mm-hmm.
We, our decision will be based on the ownership of this property, correct? How do we handle owner and proprietor being different?
Well, it's...
I'm thinking down the line.
Yeah.
Should you decide to move or whatever?
Yeah.
Should you decide to sell? Okay.
Yeah.
What happens and how do we work this out with this situation,
yeah.
sir?
Actually, if you would make a recommendation for approval and the council would approve it, the special use permit would be attached to the structure and the location, not the owner. The owner could change hands subsequently, but that permission.
Not the proprietor either.
Sir?
Not the proprietor either. It doesn't go with the proprietor.
No,
the.
Stays with the property.
Stays right. with the property.
Yeah.
So if the proprietor were to cease operation
and go somewhere
then
else,
then the special use permit would, I assume, stop. Once they stop the business, it would stop.
If they sold the business to someone else, it normally moves forward. If they are out of business for a certain length of time, then it normally ceases.
And the special use permit, if we granted it, would also stop at that time. Is that correct?
If things are vacant for a certain period of time, a lot of times they end. But once you approve a special use permit, it's permitted for that use from now on, unless there's a reason for it to be terminated.
I think the vacancy is 12 months, mm-hmm. I believe.
Does that sound right?
Yeah. I would assume that if the Planning Commission gave you the go-ahead and then City Council looking at it, you've got quite a bit of repair to do and getting it into specifications for
right,
DHS or wherever
correct.
It is.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to assume you wouldn't spend that money until you got an approval from City Council and Planning Commission move forward, and then it'd be up to the state whether you're going to be able to obtain that place for a place of business for a daycare center.
Right.
That's great.
Okay. You agree with that? You
yes.
Yes, we've obviously all looked at it, and obviously, while this may not be part of our decision, certainly part of our thinking, even though there are other agencies involved, I see a window that's boarded up halfway with plywood. I see another window broken, and as Commissioner McBride notes, we're assuming what you're holding off on perhaps doing some of this stuff until...
He's absolutely correct.
and what happens on that commission, Mr. Hanke, other agencies will make sure that happens.
Yeah,
we just want to make sure it's properly taken.
We're not sanctioning the actual daycare. That's the DHS will do that. We're just saying that for the zoning purposes, it's okay to have that type of a use at that location.
There may be some building code requirements there as well for changing type of use.
Oh, yeah, they will.
It is.
Yeah, because they're going to go in and look and tell you what it's got to be.
By the way, this is our city manager, if you did not appreciate his input. It's all right. Any other commissioner comments?
I would think that if you don't have anybody here in favor of or against you, that if...
Is that all that you folks have to offer? Apparently, we have another speaker. Anything else that you folks would like to say?
I think that's it.
That's it.
And you know, I'm sure our staff has the names, but could we have your names again, please? Brian Tyson?
Yes, sir.
And you are the owner, and ma'am?
LaDonna Wade.
How do you spell that, please?
LaDonnaWade.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
I have one last question. Do y'all have a time frame when a decision might be made for that?
To council.
Well, it'll go to council in on March 21st, I believe. Let me check real quick here for you. March 21st, it will go to council. You'll get a letter notifying you to be here if you possibly can.
Okay.
That'd be dependent on our decision this evening.
Right. Okay.
Thank you.
Listen, thank you.
And ma'am?
My name is Carol Heider, and I live at 1206 East Dallas. I've lived there for over 40 years, and I'm concerned about the daycare being in the neighborhood. I'm concerned about the traffic that would be involved, and I'm also, and the safety that would be involved there. And you said it's a commercial daycare. I don't understand what that means. I know a family daycare and
According to the description that the city provides us, a home daycare would be no more than five children there, including any that may live there. So the next step would be a child care center commercial where you can provide daycare for six or more children. It really doesn't say how many. It just says six or more. I think the Department of Human Services probably has that figured out as to the size of the location and the facility, and then they will set a limit as to how many children can be there.
Right, okay. Well, I am a former employee and a staff person of a facility, child care center, and I've worked in Oklahoma City Public Schools also. So I'm just concerned about that type of, if it's larger than that number that you're saying, I'm concerned about 20 children, 15 children or whatever, with the cars and everything, have parent having to come in and pick up children and drop off children and the transportation. I live right next to Mr. Tyson. And I'm really not, I really oppose of that. This is kind of like my place. This is my retirement home. And so I oppose of that for that reason.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Is there room for something to be put in to the decision if we agree to go with it or something on the maximum number? And by the way, I also meant to mention signs. Certainly, I don't think we want a lot of signs. This is, again, a community.
Yeah, there's an ordinance that regulates the signs for a residential.
What are the, can you
I believe it's that? One sign that's not to exceed 12 inches by 24 inches. It's more of a doctor's type
we
shingle.
We see some, of course, these are in town. We have a few of these in town, and there's certainly, yeah. There's some, well, there's a bunch of, and I see sometimes the signs on the building itself, maybe not out in front advertising.
Yeah, maybe on the porch steps or something, yeah, really.
Is there anything that can be addressed to, and your name again was Carol, please?
Yes.
Carol Heider.
Carol Heider.
Is there anything that,
no,
that
the,
can be
well,
addressed to that?
The ordinance language states six or more, and so we're not really looking at that. The DHS will regulate that, I believe. We're simply saying, is it okay to have this business, these comings and these goings in a residential neighborhood.
In your business plan, have you identified the number of children you expect to have as clients? Ten and 12, okay.
To a maximum of what, 20 or 30?
No more than, I don't think it would go for 20 or 30 children.
Okay, you're saying because of the size.
Because
perhaps
size,
you should come to
the size of the home. You want me to,
right, sure. just so that the voice picks up on the recorder.
And you say you've done this before in Oklahoma City.
Uh-huh. I did it in Oklahoma City for 10 years.
Okay.
And I also, I started in my home, and then I moved it out of my home and got, you know, rented out a house to be able to do a large home daycare. And I was licensed for that also. And from the size of the house, because it has to be so much square footage per child, and then they also have to measure out the backyard also. So when we're looking into how many children it would be, which is a facility or a building, it will be, well, you'll be able to get more kids in. But the size of the house, I don't believe that it will go from 20 to 30 children, at the most, maybe 15.
Okay.
So you're anticipating approximately 15.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
We gave you a second opportunity to speak. Thank you. Does that affect any of your thinking there, Ms. Carroll?
Well, yes, yeah, especially if she's not sure if it's going up, may go up to 20. She didn't say that it wouldn't. She said it's possible that it would go up to 20. And so that does affect my feelings.
I guess maybe I'm asking if there's any flexibility in your thinking as to what you've heard from them so
no.
That it might help us.
No, I still oppose.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Can you come to the podium, sir? Thank you.
This is for Mrs. Hyde. I don't know if you're aware. It's not my house. It's the house next door that's been vacant. That's the house we're talking about.
Could you address this all, please?
Yes. It's the, because she is my next door neighbor.
Sure.
And I was just letting her know that it's not my house that I'm trying to do this in. It's the house next door. And I was just asking her if she was aware of it.
It's 1214.
Yes. That's all. I just
clarify the address.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Commissioners, any other comments or thoughts before we maybe have a motion?
Can I ask you a question, young lady? Are you planning on living there?
No.
Okay, so it's going to be a daytime operation from
6 to 6.
And you don't think you'll have over maybe 15?
No. From the look of it, in the backyard to the inside, it's not going to measure, you know, maybe 15, no more over that.
If someone put a stipulation on you that you could have no more than 15, have you considered that you can be okay at 15 people since you're stating you don't maybe have more than 15?
Is that a stipulation that could be made as part of our situation,
sure.
Mr. Hinckley?
On a special,
on a special use permit?
Can't you put anything on a special use?
Well, as long as it's not in violation of an ordinance.
Oh, check that.
We could put that in our language, in our report to the council for consideration. Yeah.
Stipulate a maximum number.
Mm-hmm.
Because she's wanting to do the one and change it from commercial to 6 or more, right? Children.
She's wanting 6 or more, yeah.
Any further comments from our city manager to help us out here?
I'm assuming you already talked about traffic flow.
Didn't mention parking, but of course, they're more generally, it's just a drop-off situation, correct? And I note a fairly long driveway.
How many employees do you expect to have?
I would have to have, with the amount of 15, I would at least have to have four.
Okay.
So parking is necessary for them. Thank you.
And it depends on the age of the children. If you have infants, you have to have more children. Maybe more staff to attend to the infants.
If I have infants with four children, I mean with four workers, that will be enough to for workers to be able to cover the amount, but which, you know, it may, I mean, not be 15 infants, but if it's maybe half, if they have infants, then would be enough.
I'm concerned that the parking will be a problem if they, because Mr. Tyson does live next door to me, and the house is next door. The daycare, the other house that they're wanting to be the daycare is next door. And if you have that number of children, that parking may interfere with my driveway.
No, it won't interfere because they're not going to go past the house. That's going to park the whole barn, and it's going to stay right over there for that facility. That's not going to travel to my house. They're not going to be able to park over there.
But I've worked with child care facilities before. You can ask the parent not to park there, but that doesn't mean that they're not going to park there.
Good point. I assume, Ms. Carroll, you're talking more about street parking.
Yes.
Yeah. Jim, let me.
We need to have someone come to
the microphone. Yeah, if you need to talk, you really need to come to the podium. We'll get in trouble here with our lad. No. So if you've got any further clarification, yes, please come up to the podium. Thank you.
Yeah. Have you determined the amount of off-street parking spaces you would have?
Yes, we have available parking spaces that's right, it's a really big side driveway
mm-hmm.
that would go for parking. And we also, as me as the daycare provider, I have to also go by DHS rules with parking. And I have to have a handicap parking spot for mm-hmm. one, because it will be commercial.
Sure.
So I would pretty much, I have where I can lay down concrete to make those parking spots, you know, available. And also how I did it with my other daycare, with the parking, I use cones. So therefore, during the evening time at pickup and during the morning time at drop-off, we would also use cones to make sure that they don't go past those cones. This is the drop-off, you know, this is the drop-off area, and you can't go past those cones. So I used that also with my daycare in the city when I had it, and it worked pretty well.
Thank you.
If you look at our city ordinance.
We probably should have an introduction of our speaker, please.
Leroy Alsip, city manager.
Thank you, Leroy.
If you look at the city ordinances on the site plan review procedure for special use, one of the requirements in the application is a site plan. And I did not see a site plan that would show where that parking would be, playground, and those kind of things to make sure it's all going to fit on the property.
So that's something that you might want to consider before you take action, is require a site plan. And that's item B under 16-87.
Thank you, appreciate that. Any comment on that, Mr. Staff there, Mr. Hanke?
No, the picture of the driveway and the facility is the only thing that was provided. We can request a site plan from the applicant.
Well, as we look at it, and I hear noted the fact there has to be a handicap parking spot, which is very good. That might be something that that certainly needs to be addressed on where that would be, marked on the curb or whatever, so that that would definitely show out. Have we encountered some of these before where we've got into this far?
I don't believe we've ever considered more parking because of the nature of dropping off and picking up it as a temporary stop, other than we've considered our requirements for staff parking. And I don't believe we would require a handicap parking spot on the street. But if that's what...
If you know the DHS requires that, is that what... I see that, Wes.
Mm-hmm. And that's where it would be at, not
okay.
The street.
Okay. But that's required by DHS, you're saying. Okay. So I don't know that, Mr. Hanke.
Would that not affect some of the playground area?
No, because it's actually separate from the playground area.
Uh-huh.
It's another part of the driveway. You go on to the back, and then it's another long driveway in the back.
But that would take away from your playground area.
Well, it wouldn't, because I wouldn't be able to use that as a playground area, because the way it's made as a driveway, and then you have the fence, and then you go inside the fence, and there's the backyard.
Okay, and again, we need to have you come up to that. We're noting from the picture here, I see the driveway, and then going back to, you have a garage back there, it would appear. Mm-hmm. Brian, and I'm assuming that you're going to be putting your staff people back here. Is that where you're saying those four or five vehicles for staff people would be up the driveway?
Right.
And there would be
aerial
your...
Shot.
Right there.
An aerial shot?
No.
Nothing.
Just this.
The street,
so the only ones that would be in the street would be drop-off and pick-up, basically. Is that what you're saying?
No, actually, mm-hmm. It's enough space for drop-off.
Well, I'm saying, basically, the front of the home would be for drop-off and pick-up. I assume you would not be parking staff people in front of the home?
No.
In other words, staff people are going to park in that driveway, so.
Right.
Okay, just a little clarification, thank you. Commissioners, any other comments, or what do you think? Do we need a plot plan before
yes,
we go further?
Yes, we definitely need a plan that shows the layout of where parking is going to be in relation to the neighborhood. I like the idea of the cones that you've worked before. Perhaps you could indicate on there the amount of space that would be needed. I'd like to know, too, in having 15 children in this area, how would that impact the neighborhood in terms of sound? I realize during the middle of the day a lot of people are going to be at working, but we don't know that. Is there going to be some screening, fencing, that kind of thing to keep noise, you know, at a minimum? I mean, kids need to play. They need to have fun, and you're going to have the noise that goes with it, but we need to keep it down to some degree, you know. My inclination right now is that we allow you to go back and provide that information, show on a drawing where parking would be. I know the majority of times when we've approved a daycare center, it's usually been for five or less children, and I think that's the area we're trying to get our hands around, is that 15 is a larger number in a residential area as opposed to having a daycare center in a commercial zone. That's my thinking.
Another comment?
I would like to add that the majority of the people in that neighborhood are retired.
Okay.
And that in the front of the house that she's talking about, there are houses on the other side where cars are pulling in and out of their driveway. So it's not like that the front of that house is just free and there are no other houses on the other side of the street.
Well, I see in the picture that's been provided, there appears to be a chain link fence that I'm assuming will be replaced with something a little more sturdy and better looking that would contain the children.
Well, the cones, that's what I'm talking about too. I don't see where those cones would be very safe when you have people that live in that neighborhood who are going in and out of their driveways at all times.
Right. The cones would merely be for pick up and drop off, and please correct me if I'm wrong, but that's just kind of maintaining the flow of traffic during the 6 o'clock morning and evening times.
But my thing is, there's traffic all day long, morning and afternoon. So
you mean with associated with the business? Normally,
yes,
normally
right
the pickup.
Now, there's
oh, now.
Traffic
you're
now.
You're talking about traffic
yes,
on
we're talking
on
about
violence.
Traffic now.
On violence. Well, I think they're thinking the coning would be done in the morning for drop off and in the evening for pickup. And I'm assuming you'd pick those cones up. And then you know, pull them up, you know, and use them at such time as say the coning would only be done for the maximum.
But people are bagging out of their driveways.
It won't be put in people's driveways.
No, I'm not saying that. When you bag out of your driveway, it's not like they have a curb or anything that they can go out of the driveway. You have to bag back so far in the street. Mm-hmm. That's the only thing that I'm talking about, and 6 o'clock in the morning, no, it won't be bad, but in the afternoon, 6 o'clock in the evening is when there's more traffic than it is in the morning.
It would be someone to monitor that, the cones are, you know, when they're there, you're talking about if the cone may get ran over.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and it she makes a point there for what coning is for. It can happen that they can get knocked down and things, but if you got somebody looking at it, it helps. So,
well,
but a good point that you bring up.
I understand. Like I said, I'm experienced. I know what she's talking about. I know what combing is. I do know that those cones are knocked down a lot of times.
True.
By not even by the parent, but just traffic going by. And that's not really my concern. The cones, that's not my concern at all. I'm just concerned about the daycare in the neighborhood. That's
Thank
my
you very
main
much.
Concern.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you're going to bring a layout of what you intend on doing with the place, probably at the same time, it would be something beneficial to show in your property limits how you're going to cone it. I'm assuming that when you're going to cone something, you're coning in a private place in front of your driveway, in front of your property. So it would probably be beneficial to show how those cones are going to be set, when they're going to be put out, and when they're going to be taken down each time of the day.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then at the same time, show how your staffing is going to park and what you're going to do with your handicap or whatever. Nobody has any regulation over that but DHS. I think if you're going to have to bring back something, you should be as detailed as you can be on all the questions that's been asked of you today. You know.
Are you clear on probably what we need to proceed with this? Can I have do we need a little motion to do that? Can I hear that from you?
Yes, sure. I make a motion that we table this request until our next meeting, which I believe is
April 3rd at 5:30 p.m.
April 3rd at 5:30. The information that you need to bring is a site plan and at the minimum showing parking arrangements, the area to be concreted, a layout area showing coning.
Size of the play area.
Yeah, the size of the play area as well. where your fences would be located, and that would be at a minimum. And as Mr. McBride said, any other information would be helpful that you could provide. So that would be at a minimum, and that's my motion to table it so that we can get more information at the next meeting.
Have a second?
I'll second.
And under discussion, may I ask staff, would that be something perhaps they could bring in a little prior to our meeting so that if you happen to see anything that they might address a little further to help us along so that we could really arrive at a decision for you at the next meeting rather than have questions?
Yeah. Anytime before April 3rd, just come on up to the office right here and we'll look at it together and take care of it.
Can we have a vote on this, Mr. Hankey?
Commissioner McBride.
Yes.
Motion to table to April 3rd at 5:30. Commissioner Spinato.
Yes.
Vice Chairman Ogden.
Yes.
This item is tabled until April 3rd at 5:30 p.m.
Thank you all for your participation in this.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Request for future items of discussion. Do we have any staff from you or from the gang?
We are still looking into when plans are submitted for the new villas at Benedictine, which is the new the old Benedictine Hospital is going to become apartments, and they're going to have four quad units built on the grounds as well. When we get those civil drawings and they go off to our city engineer for review, we also will have you I'll look at them just for any input that you might have that would be pertinent to the project. Okay. And at the next meeting, on the April 3rd meeting, I would like to have election of a chairman and a vice chairman. Okay. That's all I have.
Can you tell us how we stand on where we, after our... after our workshop, we were going to perhaps prepare, you were going to prepare us a little, at least a draft of maybe what the consensus was. And
We need to gather more information in that regard. The workshop provided a lot of opinion as to whether metal buildings, metal-sided accessory buildings should exist or not, but not too much detail was given as to any possible language that we could use to amend the actual ordinance.
What is your suggestion there, then?
Well,
do we need a further workshop?
We can. Yeah, I think another workshop would just, you know, give us the same thing that we had before. People would show up at the public meeting and just say, we want them or we don't want them.
But I mean, we can get past that part. I mean, more the workshop now, I'm thinking about what we heard. And we heard some good input.
Yeah.
That maybe the commission itself, and if there's a special person or something, I don't think we need to have the whole big group like that. Not that they certainly wouldn't be welcome to come in, but more maybe an input from what the commissioners heard and where you where we kind of feel.
Yeah.
Unless I've got any other thoughts, and I know that Commissioner McBride wasn't there, but
yeah. I think maybe this interim period between now and the April 3rd meeting, maybe we can visit with each other and provide more information, input, just gather more information that we can make available to everyone at the April 3rd meeting, which may include a possible second workshop.
Have you got anything that you can, of course, we can't visit over two of us, of course, I mean, at a time, but have you got anything that you can either email us or something that we did get anything out of the workshop that you heard? I'm with you. I think mostly heard that the metal buildings weren't in most people's view.
We did clarify a couple points, and that's one that if it doesn't exceed 200 square feet, that it doesn't need to follow the requirements of the ordinance, and of course it doesn't need a permit as well, and that only a maximum of three accessory buildings per lot.
Of the 200 square feet or less is what we're saying.
Yes, would be acceptable. But other than that, I think we just need to start some more dialogue and gather some more information. We can email each other and share that.
Any commissioners, any idea on the best way to accomplish this? And I know...
I do have a thought. We went through a lot of information, and as you said, the gist of it was just that, you know, 200 square feet or less, it is what it is. I agree the general consensus was that metal buildings are something that the majority that we heard from didn't care for it. Given that, it sounds like the next step is to draft something, and perhaps we go down that road. I think having another workshop to pull more information through is a rehash of what we went through the last time.
Is the talk of putting metal buildings, larger metal buildings, on city lots, is that what the...
Yes, that was what it was, in that, you know, people who have a residential, who own residential property, wanting to put, say, a large garage or a large shop on their property. Right now, a metal shop or garage is not permitted with a residence within a residential district. You know, if you want something like that, then, you know, go to an industrial area or perhaps even commercial. People who have hobbies or, you know, want to do a lot of things, which, you know, I understand. You can certainly have that. You can build that, but not with a metal structure. It's not saying you can't have that. It's just what's on the exterior of the building. If the issue is that they have to have a metal structure because that's what they like, then unfortunately it needs to be in another zone,
and
not in a residential
also
zone.
Everything from location, size, visibility, what it looks like in comparison to the main structure and things like that. How do we best accomplish some drafting of something we can look at then?
Send me an email with some language in it, and I'll pass it around, and people can edit it and amplify it where they need it.
All of us may be doing some drafting. You're the collection point.
Sure. Don, just for your information, the metal building issue has been tedious. It's been exhaustive. And
it's been a pain.
Yeah. And really, previously, applications to circumvent that ordinance for an exception was brought to the Board of Adjustment. And of course, the Board of Adjustment would say yes or no. Well, when the City Council made this ordinance and put it out there for enforcement, they weren't getting any of the feedback through the Planning Commission to know if that ordinance was okay the way it was or if it needed to further study. So I think that's why we're bringing all of the requests for metal buildings through the Planning Commission, so that it does get back to the City Council, so they know.
So in other words, if they want to do something over a 10x20, it has to be before a Planning Commission and stuff, and worked on before.
Well, or permitted, whether or not.
Yeah.
And some of it just goes to the window.
Sadly, we've also run into a lot of bootlegging. That's why it's asked.
Yeah, I know.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So can you fill him in with our current information that we have as relates to outbuildings and things, so he can have a chance
to read that. Yeah, I'll give you a copy of the design guidelines. And then, of course, in your packet tonight is the results of the workshop and kind of various opinions that the attendees had.
I'm going to throw another item in the mix, and this may be something further down the road that we take a look at. This whole metal building issue is a subparagraph of a subparagraph of an ordinance that covers design issues. And looking at this one item, it takes care of an issue that's in front of us here and now. At some point in time, we may need to open that Pandora's box and look at the entire design ordinance and see what needs to be adjusted now that we lived with that design ordinance for a few years, and see what works, what continues to complement the comprehensive plan, and does that still flow with what we want the city of Guthrie to look like? So, yeah, that's a big monkey wrench in your works.
Perhaps between now and our next meeting, we can all try to find a little time to draft a little of our own thinking of what we got out of the workshop. Would that be fair enough to say?
Yeah.
Yes.
And get it to Mr. Hankey's staff. And maybe you could kind of look that stuff over and put something together and maybe send it back out to us to kind of, I know this is what we used to do, and we kind of rework the drafts a little bit and then eventually come to a meeting and and get our thoughts that way. Does something like that sound okay?
Yes, sir.
Sounds good to me.
Okay. Any staff comments other than that, Mr. Hanke?
No, sir.
Commission comments. Mr. McBride, my first comment would be good to have you aboard, and we look forward to
welcome.
Welcome right. aboard. Good to
Thank
have you.
Thank you very much.
Very glad to have you.
Thank
any,
you.
Any comments from you, sir?
No. It's interesting.
Okay. Commissioner, right?
I'm anxious to see the Benedictine project. That'll be fun to go through that. Yay.
Okay. And
it'll
I have no
it'll be nice to look at something with windows in it when I go by every morning.
Yes.
Can we include any staff comments? Is it all right to call on the Mr. Manager here to see if he had any comments for us?
Certainly.
It's good to have you here. We appreciate your interest. And any input you gave us, we always appreciate that, sir.
Thank you. I will try to get more in the future as I have a chance to review our zoning ordinance.
Okay. In that case, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
And done. Thank you.
Yahoo.